First, Eric Carson is like single-handedly responsible for me quitting vert skating. All the ramps in San Diego at that time were pretty much torn down or they just weren't that good. Tony's ramp had holes in it and it was super slow and it was just sort of deteriorating. So I go skating with Eric. We would skate a manual pad at Carl's Jr. every night till like 3 or 4 in the morning. I'd look at him and I'd go, man, what? What am I doing? I want to do that stuff. Eric's always been as good as he is right now. It's just that back then nobody knew it. So I go skating with the guy and he could do everything. So what I saw go down over the years of skating with him was just incredible, and that was it. That ended my bird skating career.
I'm usually the only guy on tour that's putting their old broken boards back in their bag and taking them home. Everyone thinks I'm a weirdo, but they're probably right.
Yeah, I feel kind of bad. Like when kids at demos ask me for like my old board, I always have to explain to them. I would, but back in 1988, when I was a kid, I started saving all my boards. It all starts right down here. This is board number one. I got Christmas 1988.
Steve Caballero, Powell Peralta. I'm pretty psyched because I got Steve to sign this for me. This was a real fun era here. This was all the late 80s. Per Wellender, Powell Peralta. Graphics got all messed up. Started to make my own graphics. Like to draw on the grip tape. All kinds of fun things on there. Rip Grip. Kids may not know about that, but it always helped when I bomb dropped on the handrails. Just gave me good grip right there, yes.
Got my Tony Hawk.
I saved up a lot of lunch money to buy this one. Nice grip tape job there. I used to write it on there with chalk and then use my mom's hairspray and hairspray over it so the chalk would stick onto the grip tape. Minor Threat. Finally broke away from Powell Peralta and I, when World Industry started, and I got Mike Vallely here. I have a few Mike Vallelys from back in the day and I got him to sign them for me, so, you know, to be friends with these guys now is kind of cool. What's cool about this is, since I ride for Black Label now, so this was my first Jeff Grosso Black Label board. I got this 1991, I think, and then here's my second Jeff Grosso Black Label board. And then here's my third Jeff Grosso Black Label board. See, I really liked this board. And this board was a marking point in my life. This was another Black Label board, and I broke it. And this is the point that I realized I had to get a job. So that's when I started mowing lawns. So this whole era here is when I went to California for my second time. I moved to San Francisco. I had no money when I lived there, and I broke boards all the time. I used to buy these blank boards, and I used to draw my own graphics on them. And that's when I met Ed Templeton. He kind of just started Toy Machine and still had old boards from his television days. So he hooked me up with these boards. Definitely for a 19-year-old kid that has never met a pro before, was really exciting to get. And here's another pivotal moment in my skateboard life. Somewhere right in here is where I actually got sponsored. I was very happy and very excited. All the way down here, these are all in the invisible days. Here's another great moment. This is the first board I got when I got on Black Label right here. Jim Gagnon. So from there on out, it's my Black Label amateur days. And move down here. This is when I turned pro. First pro model right here.
One more interesting thing started happening in my life. Like when I started traveling places, if I went, you know, here or there, I would write where I went.
See? Europe 99. Rode this on our, went to Japan.
To me, they're just photographs.
My slap cover right here.
I think I've probably got like at least 250. When I'm an old man, it'll be cool to look at them and remember the old times.
It's cool, you know, like right now being able to lay all these boards out, it's like memories, man. You look through all these boards and you remember all these times in your life that you don't have photos for, but I have the boards for. I'm glad I have them, you know. Most guys I know wish they had them. That's about it, man. That's my board collection.
But Nautis could twirl around on a fire hydrant. How crazy is that? That's the greatest contribution to skateboarding, I think. We'll be right back.
Let's go, let's do this. It's a real deal. And action. I mean, it's crazy, you know, it's like rarely in skateboarding to
say. Ah, wait. Didn't come out right. I think we should start over.
What are you talking about?
Dude, Josh, man. I mean, it was crazy. I mean, rarely, you know, in the skateboard world does someone just put
it. This ain't working.
He's out of the photo.
This ain't working, dude.
All right, get him out. Do you know how much money you just wasted? This is film. This isn't video. We're not at Love Park doing tray flips. Stay focused.
Skating in Philly is so much better than skating anywhere else. People always ask me, like, yo, man, how come you don't move to Hollywood or California or something like that? It's just like, well, I don't want to, man. Building some mini ramps and skating on roofs and things like that. I think it's safe to say that I'm staying in Philadelphia.
What is the purpose of breaking bottles?
I've been going through this problem with my girlfriend.
Cowboy f***ing me!
Hellboy.
Picture a guy named Hellboy, and that's what he looks like.
Look what she's doing to you!
What I need right now is heavy metal music. I want to play the field of
so keep on pretending. Our heavens were the waves.
Go break into Glorin's house. Look in her drawers. Look in her dirty laundry.
These are girlfriend's underwears.
You guys got the new Knockhill CD?
They have the ultimate band. If you say one more thing, I'll pull your face off.
Watch your mouth, sweetheart.
Oh, yeah, bro.
Haggard.
We're in Las Vegas right now, but the average temperature is 110 degrees, so I decided to start it on the real beginning of the day, 1 o'clock a.m. Here we go. had narrowed it down to two names, toy skateboards or machine skateboards. I think it was Ethan who said, why not just use them both, toy machine? And it just stuck ever since.
Me and Matt get to skate together probably every couple of weeks because we're both pretty busy, but when we do, we usually set up something here in SAC because sometimes you gotta be creative in Sacramento.
I've been out in Australia for 2 years and everyone's like, when you coming back to the States? When you coming back to the States? Why don't you motherfuckers come out here? Because you can drink on the streets and everyone's just a little bit more casual over here.
That's a mic.
This is leftover footage. I got some more shit for the future. So, we'll just have a little bit of a sus, alright? So, peace out. And Reynolds says, chuck on a bone.
Skateboard graphic of all time would definitely be the first generation Dogtown graphic for the Shogo Kubo run. The art was done by an artist named Wes Humston. And that graphic was always special to me because the symbols in the graphic have a lot of meaning to me, at least in my interpretation of it. It's the graphic of the rising sun with the two cobras and of course the Dogtown cross. Artist yesterday, today, and probably forever.
See him at the beach every fucking day. Trying and shit.
Get your hands up now. KRS, I'm about to show you how. Yo, what's up? Africa Bambaataa, big up. Raekwon, you God. Yo, Benz, what's up? You crazy. Prodigy. J. Rue, what's up with you? Guru. Flavor Flav. Look, we're gonna do this. Come on now. Get off of your ass.
The album is finished and available only in your local skateboard shops. February 11th, 2003.
Brought to you by 1212 Records.
Rockstar Games presents Midnight Club 2. Midnight Club 2, coming soon for the PlayStation 2. Rated T for teen. Pre-order now to avoid disappointment.
When I was in 6th grade, I had to do a report in front of the class about a vacation I had been on. The only problem was, I never went on a vacation. But I remembered all the details my mom told me about a trip she took to California. So the next day, I got in front of the class and told my mom's story as if it were my own. I want to take you on a vacation you don't have to lie about.
Alright.
I didn't touch it. You grabbed me. Who grabbed who? Chemistry. I didn't do nothing.
Building on the north side.
Copy. I didn't do nothing. You know it. Nothing.
I just told you to stay right there.
Stood right there.
How many times do I have to tell you? All right? All right?
Yeah.
All right. I don't care if you're not from here or not. When you're talking to the police, are you going to learn the hard way? I got five individuals on postal right now. I got one running.
I like to do everything a retired person does. I'm retired.
There's two things that happened to you in Santa Monica. You either got well known for something or you died. That was it.
Just opening up a magazine and seeing just a photo of Nadas and him just completely standing out.
I remember being pretty fascinated with the guy, just everything about him, you know, his name and the fact that he was 100% street.
If I had to say what his skating style was, I would just say it was like strictly brute.
Back then, skateboarding was very different. You didn't really strive to be a pro skateboarder. You just did what you did, and things kind of fell into place.
You start going on the streets and doing rails. I mean, come on, quit it. It's a destroying property. It's hurting. But they were so enthusiastic and you couldn't stop, how shall I say. The skateboarding just started, and of course we bought the boards, and Nadas would ride it ever since he walked, so to speak.
Nadas grew up in South Santa Monica, California, in the area known as Dogtown. During his early childhood in the 70s, Dogtown became famous for its good waves and aggressive locals who were pushing the limits of what was possible in the water, as well as on any paved terrain they could find. Surfing and skating were practically a given for anyone in the community, and Nadas was no exception. But by the time he was old enough to gain recognition in the neighborhood, the Dogtown hype had died down, and skateboarding was in a lull.
You know, the Dogtown thing had passed over, and it was kind of over with, so everybody was like doing drugs and surfing. It was kind of a rough neighborhood.
The drug scene was huge, and they have seen all kinds of things on the pier, as you know. So I was concerned, but I wasn't overly worried.
One of the cooler things was that we kept an eye on the younger guys because we knew there was a lot of bad shit that could happen to him. So he got to focus on his skateboarding because we wouldn't let him do anything else. His surfing and skateboarding were what he did.
In 1983, Natas placed first in a local surf contest and received as a prize an SMA skateboard. Santa Monica Airlines was operated out of the back of a surf shop as a part-time hobby of Dogtown pioneer Skip Engblom. Natas was so impressed with the board that he decided to pay Skip a visit.
And one day this little kid comes skating up to the back door of the surfboard factory where I'm at, and he goes, "I'm Natas, and I want to be on your skateboard team." I started laughing because I don't really have a skateboard team. I just make these things customs. And so I went, "Let me see you skate." So he just kind of pushed. I did this one ollie and I went, "That's it, man. I go, come here." I go, "You are the skateboard team."
Although Natas now officially had a sponsor, he and Skip remained largely under the radar of the skateboard industry. But Natas was making quite a name for himself in Santa Monica, using a new approach that involved only his local street environment.
I didn't go to pools and ramps and skate parks that much. There was a couple of little banks by the house, but it's mostly like the curbs in front of my house and benches.
You see him at the beach every fucking day, trying shit. And that's what Skipper loved about him.
You know, they were tearing it up like surfing kind of style on anything. You know, and it wasn't just that they needed banks anymore or a pool or something. I mean, it was a whole different kind of skating.
I remember the day that Natas actually decided that he could ride walls.
Everybody did this thing where they would run up to walls and throw their skate on it and kind of ride on the wall. And that was kind of the state of things, you know what I mean? And then one day, he's not using his hand. So he's skating right up to the fucking wall and bang, he's up on the wall. And he hangs up there and he skates off. Motherfucking little bastard, you know? You see that? Unbelievable.
Natas soon caught the eye of Dogtown media wizard Craig Stesic, who photographed him on a wall in Venice and sent the pictures to Thrasher magazine. Natas had never even owned a Thrasher at the time, let alone been published in it, but they were so impressed with the photo that they decided to put him on the cover.
And there's sidewalk, and then there's wall, and then there's this guy. And we're going, "All right, he's on the wall. How did you draw him in there? I mean, come on, we know collage when we see it." "Oh no, the guys really do this." And it was like, no way.
You just looked at it and you realized that his internal gyroscope was so different than anybody else's.
I think he made it more three-dimensional, you know, street skating.
As Natas acquired more coverage in the magazines, the more progressive skaters of the time also took notice.
The first time I seen him was in the magazine, and he had big bar striped shorts on, and he's all aiming to pivot on the bumper of a car.
And that was just like, what? How the hell did he get up there?
Isolated in his own environment, his skating was out of sync with the trends of the sport in the early to mid 80s.
Mostly the magazines had vertical skating. The guys we liked a lot were like Billy Ruff. On vertical, Billy Ruff was like completely smooth. So when we would skate quarter pipes or any transition, we were trying to be smooth like Ruff. When we went to the quarter pipe, we saw Natas there. And like when he came up to the quarter pipe, went up to the top, banged it, like hit it right off the top of the thing. And we're like, whoa. Cause you know, his style is more from surfing. When he's out skating, like he's going down the line, like as if he was surfing, like one constant rather than going to a spot and doing tricks.
When we'd leave his house to go skating, it was never like, well, we're just gonna roll down to the beach. It was right into tricks. It was like, as soon as he left the house, put the board down, it was like, boom, the board was flipping. Boom, it was up the curb, down the street, grinding up the curb, cut off, dodge around a couple cars, ollie over another curb, you know, down to the beach, slappy a curb, up, grind the bench, you know, it's like, I should be falling. I'm like, damn.
Natas began skating regularly with Julian Stranger, who also lived in Santa Monica, and would meet up with Mark Gonzalez, one of the few established street skaters of the time.
So I never was that clued into like the whole skateboard culture. Like I'd do stuff and then I'd meet with Mark and he'd actually tell me what it was called.
I think Natas could do whatever he wanted to do. Like it's just what he chose to do. My favorite trick to this day is a wally. I think he invented that one for sure.
We'd get together every couple of weeks and he'd see what the other guy was doing. Like, we're like, oh, like, never thought of that. I was doing this.
Mark Ignatius' frequent sessions began serving as a drawing board for what was next in skateboarding, as they pushed each other to new levels of skill and creativity. One of the many important innovations to come out of their meetings was the transfer of Rodney Mullen's Ollie Kickflip from freestyle to street.
Mark, he was the one that showed me that, and he couldn't do them either. And he was like, look, you go out, you ollie, and then you kick it, and it's just so funny, spending the whole day landing with 1 foot on, 1 foot off, like, and then finally get it. It took forever. And we got together the next month or two later, and we were both throwing them out of driveways and catching them in the air and that sort of thing.
After Nadas got his own model on Santa Monica Airlines, his growing reputation began translating into board sales. It became a problem around 1986 when the fledgling SMA couldn't keep up with demand. At age 16, Nadas surprised everyone by taking matters into his own hands and arranging a manufacturing and distribution deal between Skip and the much larger Santa Cruz Skateboards.
He actually did the deal for me. You know, the Santa Cruz wanted to have sell boards with his name on it. They had to be SMA boards, and that I was part of the equation, and there was just no going back. That was one of the great things about dealing with him, is that at 15 or 16, he was way brighter than I ever would be.
Now that SMA was part of Santa Cruz, the opportunity arose to do some filming. Nadas' breakthrough first video part in Santa Cruz's Wheels of Fire finally gave everyone a chance to see him skate and even hear his voice.
This is me going down the street. Oh, dirt.
His ability to ollie at that time had far surpassed anyone else, and the part as a whole helped cement the new direction in which skateboarding was heading.
Frontside 360 ollie 17 years ago was ridiculous.
Everything in Wheels of Fire, the ollie, when he ollied the can.
You just see something, you'd be like, Nadas could ollie that. Nadas could jump that. He could definitely jump that. That impact affected everybody skateboarding at that time.
He was doing stuff that a lot of people wouldn't think of doing. Sliding dumpsters when, you know, back in the day, that was huge. It was like, what? Nadas did this?
Santa Cruz released Wheels of Fire in 1987, expecting its vert superstars, Rob Roskopf and Christian Asoy, to create most of the hype. But as street skating began overtaking vert, Nadas' strong video part surprised everyone by generating the most response.
And people were complaining, like, oh, he's just a street skater, and his board's selling that many. It was like a bizarro world compared to now.
But as Nadas was becoming a household name, Santa Cruz began getting calls from parents concerned over its spelling. Backwards.
Nadas Kaupas. What? What kind of name is that?
Nadas' family and his name come from Lithuania. Nadas is simply the male version of Natalia, a common Lithuanian name.
Parents named me that without really thinking what it spelled backwards. People think it's got some big meaning behind it.
Ignoring the logical explanation, many schools and shops instituted a ban on any merchandise bearing the name Nadas. Even whole cities joined in, most notably Long Beach, California.
It was only about 5 years ago that they lifted that ban.
Despite the bans, kids couldn't get enough of Nadas, and his name was everywhere. But fame often became a nuisance for the somewhat reserved skater, as he was constantly hounded by fans.
He wasn't so much about the fame, so when kids would approach him, he kind of was like, hey, I'm just skating, leave me alone. I think kids would trip.
someone wanted to talk to me, yeah, we'd sit and talk. But I wouldn't want to sign autographs, I just wanted to skateboard, and that's what I like to do.
Although he had growing responsibilities running SMA, Natas was able to fit in plenty of skateboarding. He and Mark Gonzalez continued to influence and push each other as they created the building blocks for modern skating. The next big challenge for the two leaders was something most street skaters hadn't even dreamt of at the time.
It was a pro-am contest down in Oceanside, and we see Natas ride across the stage and try and board slide down this hand railing. He didn't make it, but we couldn't believe it. We hadn't heard about this. We had never seen this. We had no idea that anyone even thought like this. We all just stopped dead in our tracks and went, oh my God.
Mark and I were like almost the only people who could talk that language. You'd go skating with other people and they're like, you're kind of more showing everyone else what you're doing. We were doing rail slides on higher and higher things. Like natural thing was to take it to handrail.
I would say the Federal Building was like the first legitimate handrail that we both did.
He was a spur of the moment type of individual who was just like, there it is, try it, you know? He was always sort of one step ahead of all of us.
Soon after he and the Gons did the first recorded board slides, Natas stepped up again at the Federal Building rail.
They were the first guys that I ever saw do a 50-50 on a rail.
It's like soft aluminum those rails are. I think I had copers on too.
Breaking the handrail barrier would change skateboarding forever, as other skaters endlessly repeated and built upon the work of Natas and Gons. But Natas also became known for certain tricks that no one has ever managed to duplicate.
I don't know, I still think it was smoke and mirrors, man. I don't know what was going on. But
I've tried that forever. I'll never be able to do it.
While filming for his next Santa Cruz video part, Natas found a new way to incorporate the fire hydrant into skateboarding.
Natas could twirl around on a fire hydrant. That's the greatest contribution to skateboarding, I think.
Really, that's how he skated. He utilized everything around him, and he had moves for everything.
Natas' next video part in Santa Cruz's Streets on Fire had become a much-anticipated event, and once again defined the level of street skating at the time.
I really got into Natas was watching those videos, and it was everything, you know, Natas. I had to be Natas, everything.
trying to just emulate every single thing, like, you know, trying to get the haircut. Like, everyone was doing like the Tony Hawk haircut. We were trying to do the Nadas haircut. That was what was so amazing about it, just that someone could spark that.
Nadas's unique take on skateboarding, as well as fashion and even music, began getting him attention worldwide. He got a call one day from a French shoe designer who had seen Nadas's interview in Thrasher and wanted to start a company.
He tracked me down and threw this whole thing at me. He's this crazy French guy, but he was a great guy and I liked his ideas. And so we started Etnies.
Nadas's shoe, the first pro model skateboard shoe, was released in 1988. Having a skate shoe tested and approved by a top pro was a totally new concept, but it would set a precedent and become the standard in the industry for years to come. Nadas already had a good idea of how we wanted it to feel, but creating the look of the shoe, as well as its advertising campaign, was a completely new experience for him.
It planted a seed, like, someone's got to think of that. Someone's got to think of every last thing and think about what it does when you see all these things. I'm just trying to figure it all out, I guess.
Nadas brought his new skills and ideas to SMA, where he began laying out ads, designing graphics, and even managing the team.
We weren't skating the same way skating had been going on for years, so it made sense to kind of back that up with some artwork and just kind of get the whole attitude across.
The way I always saw it was Nadas just kind of ran Santa Monica Airlines, you know, and it was gnarly. You'd go down to him and he'd take care of you and, you know, kind of tell you, here's what you're going to get for your board sales.
At the time, Nadas had more influence on SMA than almost any other pro did over their sponsor. Realizing they could basically do whatever they wanted, Nadas and Jim Thibault decided to do a U.S. tour by driving across country in a couple of used Cadillacs they bought. Enthusiastic to do things their own way, they planned 30 demos in 40 days across America. In their excitement, they'd also overlooked many of the logistical problems in planning the tour.
You know, the first Cadillac blew up in Vegas. We bought a stolen Cadillac.
We couldn't get hotel rooms. We'd have to stay in the most ghetto hotel rooms because no one was over 21.
The tour also included Julian Stranger, Mickey Reyes, and Alan Peterson. While in New York, they also discovered an amazing young powerhouse named Sean Sheffy, who joined the tour and would later ride for SMA. Although a bit disorganized, the Cadillac tour was a success and touched the lives of many up-and-coming skateboarders.
And at a demo, and we're rail siding this box. Gino Iannucci is one of the kids holding up that box.
Despite all the excitement Nadas and the team had generated on tour, they returned home to find that the 80s skateboarding boom had begun to fade. Undeterred, Nadas continued to push SMA and himself to new levels. We'll be right back. By the early 90s, skateboarding had followed the U.S. economy into a full-blown recession, and the companies that managed to survive were cutting way back. Nadas began to feel that the effort he was putting into SMA wasn't quite paying off. At the same time, his friend and fellow pro skater, Steve Rocco, had just started World Industries. It was based on the ideal of keeping skateboarding creative and fun, and was completely run by skaters.
Now it's normal for skaters to run a company, but at the time it was some guys.
Seeing what Nadas had achieved with SMA, Rocco offered him his own brand under World Industries with complete creative control.
For some reason, we just thought 101 Dalmatians was a great idea to name a company, just to kind of not be so serious about it. I think at the time we went to go register the name. We're like, maybe it's not such a good idea. Like, let's just call it 101 or 101.
Over the next few years, 101 would become an incubator for Nadas' artistic direction, as well as some of skateboarding's greatest talents. In 1992, Nadas was finally at the helm of his own company and was still skating strong and was poised to establish 101 as a major brand. But a single injury would soon change all that.
A definite turning point was breaking my ankle, and I had to get an operation and got a plate put in.
You know, when we heard he broke his ankle and how bad it was devastating. It was just the way skating is too, you know. You cannot take it for granted.
If you have a hard injury like that, getting older, it's hard to rebound.
I was up for like a few months not skating, and at that time I learned, I bought a computer. It was a Mac 2FX, top of the line, with a color monitor, a scanner, and a printer. And the whole thing was like $20,000. And I just sat around drinking coffee and learning how to use it.
With a new creative outlet, Nadas found himself redirecting his energy from skateboarding to design work. He sought opportunities to test his ideas and was soon invited to work on a new magazine being launched by World Industries.
Nadas worked on the very first Big Brother. The first thing we worked on together was this Adam McNatt piece, and it was just this really sort of arty photo essay. And he laid the whole thing out. It was really great. He had these great sketchbooks. You know, we sometimes just scan those in for backgrounds. I don't know, he's constantly doing art.
His hands-on experience with 101 and Big Brother was an education in itself. But Nadas' life in art began much earlier. Growing up in an artistic and eclectic community, his parents filled the house inside and out with sculpture, photography, and paintings. He was also influenced by local Santa Monica artists, Wes Humpston and Kevin Ansel.
You know, he would want to draw, so we would help him draw. We'd show him stuff. And
he used to love to come over to my garage where I used to live behind my folks' house. I used to do, like, stuff on boards for people.
Of course, they had all the great skulls and crosses and lightning bolts and some wings. So that was great. Yeah, as a kid, I was fascinated by it.
Wesley was the original Dogtown skateboard guy. And he kind of passed it on to me. And then I kind of passed it on to Nadas.
But Nadas' influences weren't confined to the borders of Dogtown. With an early foundation in art and a keen interest in learning, he began to investigate other aspects of design.
Nadas asked real questions and tried to learn and absorb things.
Mofo was the first to tell me what art direction was. He used to work on the ads for Santa Monica Airlines. And so I really got an understanding of, as he was molding my image, basically, and the company's image, it got me really thinking, this is how everyone sees us because of him. And so I was like, okay, art direction.
As his workload increased at World Industries, he slowly drifted away from 101 as Rocco's company became less fun and more corporate.
What started as more of a friendship thing and he was looking out for me became more of a business. It was just number crunching, kind of crunched it right out.
While he still worked within the confines of World Industries, Nadas felt the need to test himself in the real world outside of skateboarding. His way out came in the form of a phone call from the offices of Larry Flint Publications.
They scouted him out. They saw the layouts in Blunt and they needed an art director for a new porn mag they were doing. It was called Rage. They had all these ideas about Rage, where it was going to be sort of more like Playboy. You know, it wasn't going to be so sleazy. but right away, Larry Flint gave up on the idea of it being this artfully done, tasteful porn magazine. So he just wanted it to be all raw with like girls. So all of a sudden, Nodis is laying out this like gnarly hardcore porn. I don't think he liked that too much. I don't know, I thought it was funny.
After his experience art directing magazines, in 1998, Nodis returned to the skateboard industry and helped to establish the short-lived Vita Shoes, a company that was co-founded by longtime friend Mark Oblo.
He just basically created our images with the logos and with the ads. And I think our ads were, at that time, a lot different than anyone else's ads. They were just sketchy handwriting and taped on type things, and he basically put it all together. And so that was all him.
Soon after Vita, Nodis was doing design work for Quiksilver and Element, companies that also tapped into his iconic status by putting him on their skateboard teams.
Nodis could draw, Nodis could paint, Nodis could take photos. And I guess that's kind of when I saw him putting it all together. And I mean, he took over and he made a major influence on probably the biggest company in our industry.
He's really added something to the brand and the influence that he's had on product and loosening things up and just his energy and the way he is. I'm really excited just from here on out to see what comes.
In 2001, Quiksilver promoted Nodis to the position of creative director alongside graphics guru David Carson.
To start the full circle that just happened, he laid out a cover of me in Transworld. He's got amazing talent, a really good teacher, and now I get to work with him.
Despite his many responsibilities, Nodis still finds time to work on a project he helped found in the year 2000. Since our very first issue, he's been the hand behind On's signature script and illustration style. Currently focusing on his art and design work, Nodis is fully healed and still skates and surfs for the pure joy of it.
Just Nodis, he's like all of our best friends, and it was just like the weirdest evolution of watching somebody who had so much natural talent, like in the water, as an artist, on a skateboard. He was just so fluid and knew how to move.
Despite the occasional tour and demo, he manages to avoid the pressures associated with a pro career. Recognizing all his contributions to skateboarding, in 1998, Element released the Nodis Coppice Pro model, and Etnies is also set to re-release his original Pro shoe in 2003.
And I made it clear, Nodis, you will have a board on Element. As long as you exist, you don't have to step on a skateboard ever again, because that's not the point. The point is that you stepped on one a long time ago, and when you did, it changed the sport, the industry, forever.
He's the pioneers, the godfathers of street skating that started it all and made it possible.
He didn't really follow what was the trend or what was cool. He kind of just marched to the beat of his own drum.
He has a reason for doing the things he does, you know? And then people copy what he does.
He's just got the same thing like Gons. He's just got it. He doesn't have to really do anything but just roll on his board and you're like, he's got it.
And magazines and videos, they'll be forgotten, but it's the true heroes and icons and legends like Nodis and Gons that are gonna endure. Those guys' names will go on forever.
I wish he got, honorary degrees, that sort of a thing. It's more lasting. It's your head, less physical.
Look at that, man. Look at that. You
Kids think I don't know, man. I know. I know about the struggle, man.
When I think of Nautis, like, I just think of someone, like, I just want to see someone, like, slappy a handrail, you know what I mean? Just smash into it and, like, take it out or, like, hit the thing and, like, you know what I mean? Like, like, that to me reminds me of Nautis, you know? And then smiling afterwards and being like, yeah, let's do that again.
I was talking to Jason Lee not too long ago. He said to me, you know, when I knew it was over at the Houston contest, Eric switched 360 flip over the pyramid. I knew it was done. I'm having a hard time backside flipping it. Because I had, you know, and I live with Eric. I've been friends with him now for like 11 years. Lived with him for about six, up until I kind of got married. Him and I got divorced. Don't use that.